Welcome to St. Jude's. For those that do not know, my name is Ed Happer, and I am the student minister here. I'm joined by Andrew Goddard and Andrew Schmidt. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Sentence of scripture for today. Know that the Lord is God. It is He who made us, and we are His. We are His people, the sheep of His pasture. Let us pray. Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open,
all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. Jesus said, "This is the great and first commandment, and a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself." Lord, have mercy on us, and write your law in our hearts by your Holy Spirit. Let's continue to pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you are always more ready to hear than we are to pray, and constantly give more than either we deserve or desire. Pour down on us the abundance of your mercy, forgiving us those things of which our conscience is afraid, and giving us those good things of which we are not worthy to ask. Accept through the merits and mediation of Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord. Amen.
Amen.
We now have the readings, thank you.
The epistle comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning at verse 2. I praise you for remembering me in everything and for holding to the traditions just as I passed them on to you. But I want you to realize that the head of every man is Christ, and the head of every woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Every man who prays or prophesies with his head covers dishonors his head, but every woman who prays or prophesies with her head uncovered dishonors her head. It is the same as having her head shaved. For if a woman does not cover her head, she might as well have her hair cut off. But if it is a disgrace for a woman to have her hair cut off or her head shaved, then she should cover her head. A man ought not to cover his head, since he is the image and the glory of God, but woman is the glory of man. For man did not come from woman, but woman from man. Neither was man created for woman, but woman for man. It is for this reason that a woman ought to have authority over her own head, because of the angels. Nevertheless, in the Lord, woman is not independent of man, nor is man independent of woman. For a woman came from man, so also man is born of woman. But everything comes from God. Judge for yourselves, is it proper for a woman to pray to God with her head uncovered? Does not the very nature of things teach you that if a man has long hair, it is a disgrace to him, but that if a woman has long hair, it is her glory? For long hair is given to her as a covering. If anyone wants to be contentious about this, we have no other practice, nor do the churches of God. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. The Psalm reading for today is Psalm 100. O shout to the Lord in triumph, all the earth. Serve the Lord with gladness and come before his face with songs of joy. Know that the Lord, he is God. It is he who has made us and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Come into his gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. Give thanks to him and bless his holy name. For the Lord is good. His loving mercy is forever. His faithfulness throughout all generations. Glory to God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, as in the beginning, so now and forever. Amen.
The Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke chapter 11, verses 14 to 26. Glory to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Jesus was driving out a demon that was mute. When the demon left, the man who had been mute spoke, and the crowd was amazed. But some of them said, "By Beelzebul, the prince of demons, he is driving out demons." Others tested him by asking for a sign from heaven. Jesus knew their thoughts and said to them, "Any kingdom divided against itself will be ruined, and a house divided against itself will fall. If Satan is divided against himself, how can his kingdom stand? I say this because you claim that I drive out demons by Beelzebul. Now, if I drive out demons by Beelzebul, by whom do your followers drive them out? So then, they will be your judges. But if I drive out demons by the finger of God, then the kingdom of God has come upon you. When a strong man, fully armed, guards his own house, his possessions are safe. But when someone stronger attacks and overpowers him, he takes away the armor in which the man trusted and divides up his plunder. Whoever is not with me is against me, and whoever does not gather with me scatters. When an impure spirit comes out of a person, it goes through and places seeking rest and does not find it. Then it says, 'I will return to the house I left.' When it arrives, it finds the house swept clean and put in order. Then it goes and takes seven other spirits more wicked than itself, and they go in and live there. And the final condition of that person is worse than the first." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
On hearing the word of the Lord, let us now affirm what it is as Christians that we believe in saying the Nicene Creed together. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is, seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, a one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven. It is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Please be seated, everyone. Good morning to you. My name's Andrew Schmidt, in case we hadn't met. And just before I preach, a short bracket of church news. There are some really good publications in the porch for you. There's the new CMS, Church Missionary Society, quarterly magazine, Checkpoint, which will give us lots of news about what CMS is doing worldwide. The Southern Cross, we had only a few of them last week and they all went. There are some more. That's the Sydney Diocese magazine, which has got lots of good stuff in it for you. And also, there's a conference that I just wanted to let you know about in 3 weeks' time called the National Grandparent Conference. This looks like a really good conference. It's being held at Fig Tree Anglican Church, which is a bit of a trek from here, but it's also online. I think that looks like something really worthwhile, so do read the short note that I've written about it, and also pick up a brochure if that is something that would interest you. Finally, just in case you didn't know, Jim and Helen are on holidays for a very well-deserved break. They're away for 3 weeks, including last week, today and next week, so we will see them back here in about 2 weeks' time. Let's pray. Gracious Father, please speak to us now. As I speak, we ask that you might enable me to speak the truth, and so that we all might understand the meaning of your word and also put it into practice. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Well, hasn't God done a good thing by making us male and female? It's a good difference, isn't it? As a man, I like what I share in common with other men. And I've appreciated so much the men that God has put into my life, from my father and my grandfathers to workmates, friends, church fellas that I know, and of course, my son, who's 15, so he's kind of nearly a man. I'm equally pleased and grateful for all of the women that God has put into my life. From my mother and my grandmothers to, again, friends, women that I've worked with. I've greatly appreciated all the women that I've worked with in Christian ministry. And, of course, my wife, who is an amazing gift, and my daughters. It's a good difference. Those who've been married, I guess, have experienced the special complementarity of the sexes in a particularly full way. But whether or not you've been married, I think most people would agree that God did a very good thing when he made us male and female. It's so good to have that different perspective. It's so good to have altos and sopranos as well as the tenors and basses. I mean, we could go on and on. I don't for a minute want to downplay the pain that some have experienced in failed marriages or because the stronger sex, which is men, have made not good use of their power. But even in a fallen world, I still want to praise God for making us male and female. Praise God for making us the way that he has. Doesn't Psalm 100 really get it right when it says, "Let us praise our Maker. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture because he made us and we are his, we belong to him." I guess it's a fairly basic point, isn't it, for Christians that God created us. You get it in the first chapter of the Bible. But actually, it's worth dwelling on the point because I don't think we understand it very well. God created you. You only exist because God decided that you should exist and give you the gift of life. He designed you, including your gender, and he has a purpose for you. Now, I wonder, do you think that we can rebel against our God-given gender? Do you think we can perhaps sometimes resent the responsibilities that can come with God? that we can perhaps sometimes resent the responsibilities that come with being the person God has made us. Now, I have always thought, this is going to be a curveball for you today, but I have always thought that there was a hint of this in beer advertising. Beer ads obviously are generally aimed at men, and it seems to me that beer ads in particular always show men throwing off the shackles of responsibility and doing what they like, sometimes in very strange ways. It's as if the ad is saying, if you drink this beer, you won't have to be responsible. Men like the idea of a world in which they don't have to take responsibility. Now, if you want me to give an example of how women might want to resist the responsibilities of being women, well, I'm afraid you're going to be disappointed. I'm not brave enough to go there at all. If you're a woman, you'll be able to perhaps think of your own example. But the point is that in our sin, sadly, we're not always content with the person that God has made us to be. And this was shown through in Corinth in the way that they dressed for public worship. There were certain conventions as to the way men and women should dress, particularly in regard to hair and hats. And they were flouting these conventions to the detriment of the church's reputation. Now you might say, well, so what? I mean, it's only hats. And aren't conventions there to be flouted? But actually, when someone flouts a convention, it usually does have a deeper meaning, doesn't it? The deeper meaning here was that they were trying to blur the good gender differences that God has created. And that's why, in a slightly tongue-in-cheek way, I've called this sermon today, Hats and the Meaning of Life. Because yes, true, this passage is about something which in itself is unimportant, hats, but it goes to the very deepest issues, to men and women, creation itself, and the public worship of God. The big principle, and if you're following my outline, this is point one, the big principle which Paul has to remind them is in verse 3. I want you to know that the head of every man is Christ, the head of woman is man, and the head of Christ is God. Well, there are three statements there, all of them very important, but I'm sure that for all of us, the one which really stands out is the middle one. The head of woman is man. Now, it may surprise you to know that I'm not a silly person, and I realize that this teaching is hard to accept in our culture. And in fact, even though I'm the hardline Bible guy, I'm also a part of this culture. And so even for me, it is awkward to accept that the head of woman is man. I mean, it's not as though I feel particularly well equipped to exercise headship, and let alone that I somehow would feel entitled to headship because of this passage. Nothing could be further from my mind. I'm just thinking, well, okay, if this is God's teaching, how can I live it out in a way that is pleasing to God? I think it is clear enough that these words refer primarily to the marriage relationship. The Greek words for man and woman can also mean husband and wife. And we know from Ephesians chapter 5, where Paul teaches on marriage at greater length than he does here, that he teaches there that the husband as the head of the wife is meant to lead the marriage in a self-sacrificial way, laying down his life for his wife, and that the wife is to submit to that loving initiative. So the reference to headship and submission is to do with the marriage relationship. The reason why on either side of speaking about the man and the woman, he speaks about Jesus in his relationship to mankind and in his relationship to God, is because the perfect life that Jesus lived provides an example both to men and to women for how they are to fulfill their parts in the order that God has made. Men are to look at the way that Jesus exercised his headship over the whole human race. What did Jesus do? Well, he loved us, and he took the loving initiative with us, and he came to die the death that nobody imagined was necessary so that we could be forgiven for our sins and be with God forever. Well, that is the sort of loving initiative that men ought to show with their wives. Women are to look at the way that Jesus submitted to his Father. The Father, it says, is Jesus' head. And so Jesus, even though he is God himself, he is very God, he willingly submitted himself to God the Father in his plan to save the world through Jesus' death. So you see, headship and submission in a Christian marriage is a beautiful reflection of the gospel itself. And that's why it's nothing to be embarrassed about, but is part of God's good plan. As I said, I know that male power is sometimes tragically misused. But I suspect that here today, we have many, perhaps a majority of women who, in your own marriages, if you've been married, in your relationships with the men who've been in your life, your father or other men that have been in your life, there would be very many women who would be able to say, well, actually, maybe would I use the word submission? Maybe, maybe not. But there have been men in my life who I'd say, it would not have been silly at all to submit to that person because either consciously or unconsciously, he was trying to be like the Lord Jesus Christ. So we can and we should trust God's vision for the relations between men and women, and we're to live it out in practice. And for the Corinthians, a key part of living out God's vision for gender relations had to do with the way that they presented themselves in public worship. This is my second point. Verse 4 says this: every man who prays or prophesies with his head covered dishonors his head. So the situation Paul's speaking about here is it's the gathering of a church. It would have been much like our gathering here today, although in those days they were gathering in homes because there were no church buildings. It's only 30 years after Jesus had died and risen. In fact, even less, probably 25. And in the church gathering, people are praying. I guess you'd say they were leading in prayer. Prophesying refers to any sort of talk about God, whether it's in a teaching session, whether it's simply an announcement or an interview, a book review, a children's talk, whatever it might be, that's what prophesying is about. Now, public worship, would you agree that public worship is very important? I would say there's very little that happens on this planet that's more important than the public worship of the living God, what we're doing today. So if you were doing something that's that important, you wouldn't want to dishonor your head in the process, would you? It's clear from this passage that in the Corinthian context, it was going to cause dishonor if a man prayed with his head covered or if a woman prayed with her head uncovered. Now, many people would say that the reasons why their headwear carried meanings like that were specific to their culture. Others might suggest that there is something timeless that's built into the creation that meant that they ought to wear their hair that way. And if that were the case, I guess you'd have to say we were out of step with it, wouldn't you? Well, I would let you draw your own conclusions about that. The point is, though, that as Christians, we ought to show that we do believe God created us male and female, and that it's a good thing. And that if there are culturally appropriate ways that we can symbolize that in public worship, show the world that we believe gender difference is a good thing, then we should do those things. We should show the world that we're positive about gender difference because God created it, and he's a good God. Paul says more about the creation in verses 7 to 12, which is my point 3, if you're following. He reminds us, particularly in verses 7 to 12, of the beautiful passage in Genesis 2, where God made the woman from the man's rib. And he draws certain conclusions from that around headship. But with the limited time this morning, I want to focus on verses 11 and 12, where I think there is a counterbalance to the headship submission pattern. If there were, heaven forbid, and I can't imagine how this would be, but if there were any man here today who were feeling puffed up and entitled and thinking, oh yes, well I'm the head, well these verses are here to cut us down to size. In the Lord, Paul reminds us, neither men nor women are independent of the other, and all things come from God. At the end of the day, all things come from God. He made us all. He is the final authority. And don't forget, God will hold everyone to account for the way that they use the authority that he entrusted to them. That's for everyone from the national leader, someone who's literally in charge of the power of the military, to the school principal, to the policeman, to every husband and father who is usually the physically strongest person in the household and will be held to account for the way that that power was used. Everyone to whom God entrusted power will give account to God. Now, if after all that I've said, if you still think that this setup that God's created is not very equal for women, think of this. In the new creation, where Jesus' followers will live in paradise with him forever and ever in God's presence, there really will be absolute gender equality, because there won't be marriage. As Jesus said, we'll be like the angels in heaven. So, Paul again says near the end of this passage, like he did back in chapter 10, judge for yourselves. He encourages Christians that we are to think for ourselves in obedience to God's word. And so we here today should think about how we, in our context, can affirm the good gender differences which God has created. I feel like we've only just got started really to think about this issue, and it needs a lot more thought. But to get really practical, and at the risk of introducing what you call a hot button topic, isn't it obvious that this passage invites us to think over the issue of transgenderism? We have learned here today that God made us male and female, that he chooses the purpose for us, and that his design is good and loving. It teaches that we are to trust and to live out the good gender differences which God has made, even in the way that we dress. So how should we respond when someone presents with what is called gender dysphoria? That is the sense that they feel in their mind that they are not the gender that corresponds with their body. Now, I'm speaking as someone who has not had direct experience of this issue. The first and the obvious thing to say from a Christian perspective is that our friend with gender dysphoria is someone whom we are to love and listen to. I think listening to someone is just about the most important way to love them, isn't it? People find that to be incredibly important. So we love them and we listen to them, and we remind them that no matter what, they are a precious person who's been made in God's image. Another question which comes up today is whether we ought to help our friend to change their gender through medical treatment. Now, there seem to be a lot of people around today who think that the only way of caring for the person is to affirm without any question their desire to change gender as far as that's possible with hormone therapy and surgery. The Victorian Parliament recently passed legislation which makes it illegal, virtually, to do anything other than affirm the desire to undergo a transition. But God's word suggests that our instinct should be quite different from that, doesn't it? Our instinct, given that we trust the God who made us, our instinct should be first to ask, well, is there actually a way that we can help our friend to trust and accept their God-given gender? There is an increasing amount of evidence that the Christian instinct is the right one. It has become very clear that feelings of gender dysphoria often go away by themselves without any medical treatment. You might have read in the Sydney Morning Herald only this week the terrible story of a young woman who was subjected to appalling, disfiguring surgeries, which she now regrets, because she was given completely one-sided advice about how to address her gender dysphoria. And that is not an isolated incident. Now, it's fair to acknowledge that there seem to be people who are satisfied with their gender reassignment surgery. But it is telling that on a statistical measure, these surgeries are not reducing the suicide rate among those who face this very challenging condition. As a society, we need to rethink our response to gender dysphoria and stop harming the people who are presenting with it. Now, within the Christian community, if we take it that transitioning is generally going to be against God's will, and I think that's the message here, what will we do with someone who's undergone such a process, who's transitioned? Well, the same as before. We love them. We love them, don't we? Just the way that Jesus does. Even if we wouldn't agree with all of the choices they've made. I tell you what, if you had to stop loving someone every time they made a choice you disagreed with, your circle of friends would have shrunk rather rapidly and dramatically, wouldn't it? We need to learn in this society, and this is what the world out there just cannot grasp. You can love somebody without agreeing with all of their choices. It's pretty basic, isn't it? That's what Jesus has done for us. So we love them. But for our part, as disciples of Jesus, we just keep on trusting that God was very wise when he created us, and that it's a good thing that he made us male and female. Let's pray. Our Father, we are so glad to be the sheep of your pasture, whom you have made for your own good purposes. Please, Father, help us to come to you in the worship that you deserve. And Father, we praise you for making us male and female. Father, you know very well that there is pain around this issue in so many different ways, yet your creation is wise and good, and your redemption of us through the Lord Jesus Christ is wise and good and loving. So please, Father, we ask you, help us to keep trusting you in this and in every area of life. We pray for Jesus' sake. Amen.
The offertory hymn is Come Thou Fount, and it can be found in the yellow sheets.
Of mercy, never ceasing, call for
Let us pray for all people and for the church throughout the world. Almighty and ever-living God, we are taught by your holy apostle to make prayers and supplications and to give thanks for all people. We ask you in your mercy to receive our prayers, which we offer to your divine majesty. We pray for scripture in our schools. Thank you for the opportunity to teach so many kids the good news of your son Jesus. We pray particularly for scripture in Randwick Public School and Randwick Girls and Boys High School. Thank you for the teachers who are part of those classes, for their desire each week to teach the kids about Jesus. For the students, we pray that you will give them a thoughtful and engaging mind, and to grow in them a heart that seeks for you. We pray for the teachers that you will give them a deep understanding of the good news, patience and perseverance with the students, and compassion for all that they come across. We also thank you for our kids' club. We pray for the children and for the leaders. Thank you for all the children who attend each week. We pray for those who are new and those who do not come from Christian families. Thank you that they are able to hear the good news of your son. And we pray that you will grow this community and the relationships within it. We pray for the leaders as well. Thank you for their desire each week to share with the kids the good news of your son. And we pray that you will continue to give each of the leaders great wisdom as they do this. We pray for the preservation of our environment and its resources. Help us to be good stewards of your creation. Thank you for the creation that we have inherited, and we pray that we will do all we can to pass it on to future generations as it has been given to us. Help us to encourage those in positions of authority to make wise decisions for the good of all. We also pray for those serving in frontline services, for police, fire, and emergency workers. We thank you for them, for their service to us all in our times of greatest need. Please give them strength, wisdom, and compassion and endurance as they seek to carry out their duties in often difficult circumstances. We pray for married and for families. Thank you for the gift of marriage. Thank you that it is a reflection of the bond between Christ and the church in which we all share. We pray for all those who are married in our community, that you will strengthen their relationships to be blessings to each other and to everyone around them. We also pray that you will bless all families. Help mothers, fathers, and guardians to love and care for the children that you have placed in their protection. And we pray that those that know you will pass on to their children a deep love and knowledge of your son. We know that in our broken world, marriages and family relationships can also be broken and even hurtful. Please uphold and care for those who are vulnerable and enable us to advocate for those who are in difficult circumstances. We pray for those listed in the prayer journal. Guard their hearts, help them in their time of need, and fill them with the knowledge and love of your son, Jesus. We pray that you will lead the nations of the world in ways of righteousness and peace, and guard their rulers in wisdom and justice for the tranquility and good of all. Bless especially your servant Elizabeth, our Queen, her representatives and ministers, her parliaments, and all who exercise authority in this land. Grant that they may impartially administer justice, restrain wickedness and vice, and uphold integrity and truth. We beseech you to inspire continually the universal church with the spirit of truth, unity, and concord, and grant that all who confess your holy name may agree in the truth of your holy word and live in unity and godly love. Give grace, Heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, especially Kanishka, our Archbishop, Michael, our Bishop, and all ministers who serve in the churches. We pray that by their life and doctrine, they may set forth your true life-giving word,
and rightly and duly administer your holy sacraments. And to all your people give your heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that they may receive your word with meek hearts and due reverence, and serve you in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. We ask you in your goodness, Lord, to comfort and sustain all who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. We also bless your holy name for all your servants who have died in the faith of Christ. Give us grace to follow them, their good examples, that with them we may be partakers of your heavenly kingdom. Grant this, Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate. Amen. You who truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbours and intend to live a new life following the commandments of God and walking in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to strengthen and comfort you. But first, let us make a humble confession of our sins to Almighty God. Almighty God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all people, we acknowledge with shame the sins we have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against your divine majesty, provoking most justly your wrath and indignation against us. We earnestly repent and are heartily sorry for all our misdoings. Have mercy on us, most merciful Father. For your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake, forgive us all that is past, and grant that we may ever hereafter serve and please you in newness of life, to the honour and glory of your name. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Our next hymn is hymn number 202, I Know That My Redeemer Lives.
Hear the words of assurance for those who truly turn to Christ. God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, that whoever believes in him
should not perish, but have eternal life. The saying is sure and worthy of full acceptance that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right and our bounden duty that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Lord, mighty Creator and eternal God. Therefore, with angels and archangels and with the whole company of heaven, we proclaim your great and glorious name, evermore praising you and saying, Holy,
holy,
holy, holy, holy. Lord
God of hosts,
heaven
and earth are full of your glory. Glory to you, O Lord most high.
Let us continue in prayer together. We do not presume to come to your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Grant us, therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. All glory to you, our Heavenly Father, for in your tender mercy you gave your only Son, Jesus Christ, to suffer death on the cross for our redemption, who made there, by his one oblation of himself once offered, a full, perfect, and sufficient sacrifice, oblation, and satisfaction for the sins of the whole world, and instituted and in his holy gospel commanded us to continue a perpetual memory of his precious death until his coming again. Hear us, merciful Father, we humbly pray, and grant that we who receive these gifts of your creation, this bread and this wine, according to your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ's holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood, who, on the night he was betrayed, took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, Take, eat, this is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. Likewise, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, Drink from this, all of you, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. Amen. I now invite those who are joining us online to join me in taking communion. Let us take and eat in remembrance that Christ died for us and feed on him in our hearts by faith with thanksgiving. Let us drink in remembrance that Christ's blood was shed for us and be thankful.
Let us pray. As our Saviour Christ has taught us, we are confident to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Lord and Heavenly Father, we, your humble servants, entirely desire your fatherly goodness mercifully to accept this, our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and to grant that, by the merits and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and your whole church may receive forgiveness of our sins and all other benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present to you, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy and living sacrifice, humbly beseeching you that we, all we who are partakers of this holy communion, may be fulfilled with your grace and heavenly benediction. And although we are unworthy through our many sins to offer you any sacrifice, yet we pray that you will accept this, our bounden duty and service, not weighing our merits but pardoning our offences. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom and with whom, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honour and glory are yours, Father, world without end. Amen.
Hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. The blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord.
In the name of Christ.